with the introduction of lamellar keratoplasty, there is a paradigm shift in corneal surgery. There are so many things has happened. If you go to about 5 decades ago or something, something was different. However, the concept was not new. It was much before than penetrating keratoplasty. However, it was not popular as it was technically very difficult, it was time consuming, and most importantly, it provides the suboptimal visual outcome due to interface irregularity. However, the effort was made to make a smooth bed. To obtain a smooth bed, in 1972, Josh Baraker used the microkeratom. In India, we did not have access to microkeratom. Therefore, we have adopted the manual close method, and the results were equally good. Thereafter, in 1984, acrylatride air dissection, and which gives definitely much better result. All the techniques were compared in early 90s and found it was all were comparable. If you see the milestone, what has been changed? There was anterior stromal keratoplasty or anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Now the technique is going towards the deep stromal keratoplasty. It was annual in early 90s. Who has introduced the technique? Thereafter, the ALTK has been introduced and it founds. It is a very good technique. However, we are going to say something about that. Thereafter, the combined surgery in lamellar keratoplasty has been introduced. Other milestone, as I said, DALK was popularized in early 90s by Anwar. Then it was compared the DALK with penetrating keratoplasty. Then for the good separation, endoscopic visualization using tri-pan blue has been used, and it is also excellent, gives excellent separation to the lamellar area, lamellar layer. Then combined deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty along with phacoemulsification has been successfully done. Then in 1994, the other things was introduced, that was posterior lamellar keratoplasty, and today it is very popular. In 1999, something was manual posterior lamellar keratoplasty was tried, as we did not have any equipment. Then we were successful to do manual posterior lamellar keratoplasty, and something extra we have done, that is utilization of anterior stroma for anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Only lamellar keratoplasty, as we all of us know, Kaufman has introduced it in 1980 for keratoconus, and he has used the preserved cornea, automatic and preserved lenticle. However, it was very expensive. Indian patient cannot afford it. Therefore, we have followed the manually dissected lenticle in 1990. Thereafter, excimer laser like PTK has been introduced. Then, recently, the femtosecond laser is getting popularized. Other modification has been done along with anterior lamellar keratoplasty, that is simultaneous anterior lamellar keratoplasty with manual small incision cataract surgery for peripheral corneal ectasia and total cataract, combined deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty with phacoemulsification, and finally the sutureless lamellar keratoplasty. I'll show all this video to you in the next lecture. Thank you so much. With this, I will request Dr. Srivatha, who is going to tell us about the instrumentation.
I would like to thank Dr. Panda for giving me this opportunity to be part of her IC. Much of this lamellar corneal transplantation surgeries is basically lamellar dissection. As ma'am has already said, there's a paradigm shift. There's almost more than 60 to 70% of the surgeries that happens today is mostly the lamellar corneal surgeries. And what was once considered to be difficult has now become more commonly done because of the improved microsurgical techniques and also because of the instruments that are available these days. As we categorize them into anterior lamellar keratoplasty, which includes an SALK, ALTK, and DLK, and specific endothelial keratoplasties, which could be an automated endothelial keratoplasty or a manual DSEK and a DMEK. I would just like to first take the instruments as we deal with each kind of procedures. First, for a manual lamellar keratoplasty, this Hesburgh-Baron suction trephines were the ones which have been very helpful in terms of because it helps in the recipient corneal trephination to the appropriate depth that we need. This is a spring-loaded disposable syringe that creates a negative pressure and it helps the keeping the globe stabilized. There's an outer ring which is there for fixation and there's an inner circular cutting blade. This crosshair helps in optimal centration. It's available in various sizes in 0.5 increments. With every 90 degrees of turn of this blade, we can see that the trephine cuts approximately 60 microns. There are various lamellar dissectors that we have, which help us to guide our plane of dissection. The most common and the cheapest one is the crescent knife that we have, the guarded diamond knife, which helps us in the initiation of the dissection from the periphery, and the other named ones like Tuke's Porfix knife and Jill's lamellar dissector. Desmas lamellar dissector is the other one, which is something quite commonly available. As I said, the guarded diamond knife helps us in the initiation of the dissection. This because of the foot plate that is there, it guards the depth of dissection and there's marking in the scale of 10 microns and with one full rotation, we complete 100 microns. And according to the depth of dissection that we need, we can preset it and accordingly we can mark in the periphery of our trephination mark. The crescent knife, as I said, is the cheapest available instrument which every surgeon can have access to it, and this helps us in the open dissection wherein we can just cut the fibers of the corneal lamellae easily. And Desmas lamellar dissect is another thing which is easily available. In automated lamellar keratoplasty, here came the utilization once we had access to these automated microkeratomes from the Moria. This Moria microkeratome with artificial anterior chamber system has helped in trephination for both the donor cornea as well as on the host. There are pre-calibrated heads available from various thickness from 130 to 400 microns. The 400 micron head being exclusively used for donor cornea dissection for a DSEC button, whereas 250 microns is used commonly for the recipient host cornea. The artificial chamber system, it is a stainless steel structure. It has a 3 screw type safety rings. The first one is mainly to hold the sclera in place, and this is the second one which is to keep it tight, and there's a track on which the microkeratome head moves along. It is important that throughout the time of this donor dissection, before initiate this, make sure that your vacuum levels is everything is in the green zone, and then you proceed with the dissection of the donor cornea on this artificial chamber system. The recipient bed preparation, the suction ring, the size of the ring that you use determines the size of the host trephination that happens, and the depth would be determined by the head that you use. When we come to the DLK, we had, as it was started and innovated by Jared Mellies, he's had his own sets of instruments for various purposes, the red, white, and the blue spatula. The red was for the periphery, it's a triangular, short triangulated instrument. The blue spatula was for through and through throughout the whole of the cornea for dissection. After the initiation and innovation of this big bubble technique, we have various cannulas that guide us and help us in injecting the air bubble in the deep stroma for the separation from the deeper layers. And these cannulas are basically blunt tipped and they have the bevel down. And once we are deep in the layer, once we inject the air bubble, we have the plane of separation. And these cannulas come very handy. We also have a four-glass cannula, there's other cannulas as well. Coming specifically to the endothelial keratoplasties, again here the donor preparation, the automated microkeratome has really come in handy. Where we do not have access to the automated microkeratomes yourself, these days the eye banks also supply pre-cut tissues. If not, you're very skilled, you can still do the manual dissection and they also give very good results. The automated microkeratome that, as I already said, for the DSEC, we use 400 micron if we prefer to have a thin lenticule. 350 microns has been contemporarily used in the past. The ultra-thin grafts, which has been popularized by Busin et al., it involved a two-pass technique wherein, you know, we have various heads ranging from 50 microns to 300 microns. So they said that first we do a debulking cut wherein, you know, we do much of the thickness of the donor is done away with. Then depending upon the desired lenticule thickness that we require, we can do a refining cut. If the donor that you get after the first pass is less than 150 microns, you can leave it as it is and use this. This is very much a thin lenticule. But if it is much thicker, you can go ahead and use further microkeratome heads that you have to get a thinner lenticule. Having said that, using a 400 microns has reasonably given good thin grafts for us to have good post-op outcomes. Femtosecond laser donor dissection, as ma'am has already said, it has been something which is recently in vogue. But having said that, everyone having an access to this femtosecond platform as well as the cost of the procedure really makes it not so practical to use. The recipient preparation in DSEC also involves a few specific tools that we require. First is a marker ring so that we have the which guides us in the adesimate membrane scoring. Reverse Sinsky hook, which is used for the adesimate scoring after staining it with the tripan glue. And there are various adesimate strippers that are available that helps us in stripping of the adesimate membrane along the entire marked area. There are various strippers named by Teddy, Laya, Melis, and many things. The graft insertion techniques in DSEC, the instruments that I've used, that have really changed much, and we see very many varieties, all of them, each of them trying to see by which technique or by which instrument we can actually reduce the endothelial cell loss, because at the end of it, we want to give patient the benefit of having the maximum endothelial cells transplanted and least damage during the procedure and the graft insertion. To start with, what we had used was forceps, wherein the most important thing is this is a single point tooth forceps where there is non-compressing edges of it, and this allows us to fold the graft in the TAPO 4060, and we can just directly insert the graft into the anterior chamber. The sutures pull-through techniques have been used in the past, but what has been most commonly used is the Busin endothelial glide. The original one, which was a 5 millimeters, and the recent modified Busin glide, which is a 3.5 millimeters opening, and thus reducing the size of the wound that we have during the surgery. It's a funnel-shaped device, and it avoids folding of the graft nor the graft, you know, touching anywhere during the insertion at the wound. It's a bimanual technique is required, wherein you hold this glide at the main port, and using your forceps, which is devised by Busin, or a 23 gauge intravital forceps, we can pull in the graft through the opposite limbus. The other one, which has been devised by Tan and et al., is the Tan Endoglide. They again have, it's a cartridge-based system wherein you load the graft onto that insert it and inject into the anterior chamber. These are the Tan Endoglide forceps, which is used for pulling the graft into the anterior chamber. There are the injection devices available, like the Nucil Conley inserter, there is Endoserter. For DMEC, again for dissection of the donor decimate membrane, the scoring and this thing, we need to have fine forceps. There's a cartridge that is being used to insert and inject the rolled decimate membrane into the anterior chamber. With this, I would like to leave for the next presenters to take us to the next discussions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sulakar. Enlighten me right.
Dr. Dua, can you go for yours, or we'll wait for later?
Dr. Dua, to you, that will be a drop of water in the ocean. So I cannot dare to do that. Dr. Dua, am I right?
No, you're not. I am Dr. Dua, Harminder Dua from Nottingham. I introduce myself. Thank you. Thank you, Anita. And thank you for your very kind invitation and for allowing me to give this keynote, which is on dark tips and trips through clips. Now, just how to try and get the bubble you want. So we all do this thing, we make it refined, we put the needle in, a little drop of viscoelastic helps, to magnify the tip as you insert it. And when you're inserting the air, you can see that white ring. When you see the white ring, you know you've got a type 1 bubble. That's very crucial. And then look at this video at the bottom. I'll just stop this one, and we'll look at this one here. Now see what will happen is that you'll see the bubble come and spread right to the edge of the cornea over there. And that, when that happens, when the bubble goes beyond your trephine edge, you know you've got a type 2 bubble. A type 1 never goes more than 8.5 millimeters. And like I said many times, you can complete a dark safely with both types, but you've got to know which type, otherwise you might end up in a problem. And this is what is happening if you take the Miyake equivalent of the cataract. Many of you have seen this before, and apologize for the repetition, but very important. So when you're injecting air, this is what is happening. You're getting a lot of leak at the periphery, but this bubble that is forming in the center, and it stops. And why do you get that white ring? Have you ever thought why do you get that white ring? It's because the pre-decimus layer is separating from the deep stroma, and there's stress on the collagen. So as soon as you release the stress by taking the air, the white ring disappears. With the decimus, you never get that. And this is the type 2 bubble, and you can see it's very thin, and this is purely the decimus that is being separated, as you can see over here. And when you see this, it'll go all the way to the periphery, and it's important to know the difference. So that is the key as far as these are concerned. Now, sometimes you can get both of them together and you can get a mixed bubble, and you should know that, because when you get it again, you can end up in a disaster situation, as I'll show you, if you don't know. And it can be very large type 2 and with a smaller type 1, or it can be the normal size type 1 and a smaller type 2. So here is, now just leave that for a moment, and sometimes you get everything is very white, you don't know whether you've got a bubble or not. And everybody knows the way to do this is do a paracentesis. Make sure your paracentesis is very peripheral, very short, don't put the needle too much. Put the air in, that everybody knows, and you can see if the air moves at the periphery, you know you've got a bubble in the center. But what most people don't know is that when you've done your paracentesis, you have released some aqueous. Now when you put the air in, the air will not move freely unless you top up with BSS. You fill the AC again with BSS and then look for the movement of air. It's very easy to see it. If you don't do that, the air will be stuck. And this is how you can tell type 1 and type 2. Now, when you see this rough looking appearance, it is type 1. When it's this very smooth appearance, it's type 2. And our chair, lady Anita mentioned, you know, she's absolutely right. She was the first one to describe DALC with cataract extraction. But what she wrote in her paper was she did the cataract and the Desmet's membrane. She didn't. She did it under a type 1 bubble. Don't ever try it under Desmet's membrane. It bursts just like that. You will never succeed in a cataract under Desmet's membrane, because at that time the concept of the pre-Desmet's layer didn't exist. But she clearly had a type 1 bubble, and she was able to do the cataract only because it was supported by the pre-Desmet's layer. And we know now that this is where you can do a DALC triple. If your bubble does not go all the way to your trephine mark, then you have to manually separate. And when you manually separate that quadrant or that half where the bubble has not gone to the trephine mark, you will come across these strands. When you see these strands, you know that you are working on the pre-Desmet's layer. You've got a lot of support and strength, and you can cut it or you can break it off with blunt dissection. And that is, again, a very useful tip and very important to know. Now, this is why you should know, again, another reason, which type of bubble you've got. Now, here you've got a mixed bubble. There's a type 1 inside and a type 2 outside. Now, imagine if you did a paracentesis. You will immediately burst the type 2 bubble. You'll have a big problem on your hands. So, if you know that, you will wait to release the air, let everything become up again, convex, instead of being like this, it'll go like that. Then you can insert your paracentesis needle. So, very important to know that. And here, if you've got a partial type two and a type one like that, you want to do your paracentesis, you will come from this side, you will not come from this side, otherwise you're going to damage your type two. So very important to recognize that during the operation. Now look what happens over here. Got a nice bubble, nice exposure, I'm trimming that and it burst. Now this you will not try with a type two. If you have a situation of a type two bubble, always release aqueous humor every 2 minutes, every 3 minutes. It is amazing the rapidity with which the anterior chamber fills up, and it will be like a tight balloon, and the moment you touch it at one point, the whole thing bursts. So releasing the aqueous multiple times allows you some flexibility in your Desmet's to complete your procedures. And this is the other example I've showed earlier. This is Kana Ramesh's video. He did this, and both these and many others have happened before we knew what was type 1 and type 2. Now we know, we can take precautions and stop these disasters from happening. Now if you do get a tear in your type 1 bubble, so you've got the pre-Desmet's layer, you've got your Desmet's filling it up, aqueous is coming out, and there's a big rent over here, so I'm putting my probe in the rent, and you can manipulate that, but because the Desmet's is tamponaded by the pre-Desmet's layer, it doesn't scroll. Very little, so we can put air inside at the end of the operation and get a very good result. So you don't have to convert to PK, even if you get a fairly large tear in your type 1 bubble. And here is the post-op. You can see there was a little fold corresponding to the region of the tear, because this is picture taken from the top and this now the other way around, and the patient is looking is sitting up. So that fold you might get because of the tear which you see over here. Now let's watch this video. See what, and watch it carefully. It's at normal speed. It's at fast speed. So I'm injecting air, and you are seeing what's going to happen here. Bubble forms, white ring, and it bursts. So there's an internal burst of the bubble. And why would that be? So you zoom in. All is not lost. You can see there's still some air trapped inside. So, okay, I've got a bubble of sorts. I will cut that and I will then follow that plane to expose whatever tissue I have underneath. So don't be afraid to use a cohesive viscoelastic. We used to first avoid Helon in these patients, but Helon comes to your rescue. What you can see here is I've got a double bubble, and this, and then touch it, aqueous is leaking, but there is no tear. And this is the double bubble there that had torn, and there was an internal dehiscence, so the desmus membrane at its peripheral attachment had come apart, and the aqueous had leaked. So I've got a type 1 and a type 2 bubble. Now this patient, post-operatively, if you look, you can see over here, this fine line over here, very difficult to photograph. That's the edge of the desmids that had come apart, but it was within the peripheral rim. So there was no bad consequence of this operation. We went ahead and did and got a good result. This is an example I've shown earlier of Dr. Pillay's patient, and he had very nice dark, no aqueous leak, but the cornea didn't clear, and he also had a double bubble and the inner one had ruptured. Now, it's very important to know this, and I think intraoperative OCT will help us recognize these sorts of issues, and then you can avoid doing a DALK in this and convert to a PK if you've got such a large rent with scrolling of the type 2 component of a mixed bubble. Now, here is a situation I ended up with, and it's an interesting learning experience. So you got to have confidence in what you're doing. So I've punctured it, the air has come out, and I'm trying now to inject the viscoelastic and trying to find that plane. And I just cannot find the plane. So I'm putting my spatula, I'm putting my cannula, and I can't find that plane. So what I do is I try my manual technique and I go dissecting all the way to the periphery. I will take one layer off and I will look for the entry site if I can find. I know I've gone through and through. So that much I know. I have to believe that I did that. I'm trying to find, I can't, so I have to take another layer off, and you will see that if you persevere, have patience, don't be pushed, and these are with ordinary instruments, you know, the ordinary crescent blade, you can go pretty deep, as you can see here, right down. But now when I clean it, I find my little opening. And then you put a spatula in, you can go in, and you can find it. So what had happened is that when I made my nick, the two lamellae had spread. So the opening here and the opening here were not lined up. They had spread like that. And I couldn't get through till I found this one, got through, made my cruciate incision, and took out the four quadrants, and was able to expose the pre-desmus layer, as you see here, and complete a good DALK operation. Just a couple more, and I'll finish. Now, this is, again, all is not lost when it seems to. This happens even in the most experienced hands. You've got the needle in the eye, and you see what's happening, right? Air in the AC. So you penetrate it at your first stroke. Do you give up and convert? No. You go to another site and you inject. I get a very small type 1 bubble, but I've got a type 1 bubble, so I can use that. And this is based on the knowledge of the knowledge that there is a plane of cleavage between the pre-desmus layer and the deep stroma. So this is a very useful trick. Whenever you are trying to enter to release the bubble, do it over viscoelastic. The air escapes so slowly, as you can see, that the desmids will not come up and hit your sharp tip of the instrument. So whenever you want to do that, again, put your viscoelastic in, and you can see manually I can now separate in that cleavage plane. And because there is a plane that offers, you can separate and you can go all the way around, and now you have done with the spatula what the air would have done for you in a type 1 bubble, and you can create that cleavage all the way to your trephine mark, and then you cut the four quadrants and you can take out the deep stroma, and then you can put your new cornea with the without the desmus. Now when you're cutting this, it's very important that you cut this all the way to the edge of your trephine mark. See, look at that tip of the needle, your scissors, sorry, should come all the way to the edge. If you leave a little bit, it'll be extremely difficult to cut it completely and you leave a ledge. So you cut it all the way. So that's one. And the other tip over here is when you're cutting the quadrant, you always slide your scissors in flat and make it vertical when you're cutting. So slide it flat and always make it vertical to cut. That way you get a straight edge. Like you can see how I'm going in flat, then I'm turning it to make it vertical. Going in flat, but turning it to make it vertical so that I get a very nice, clean vertical edge which I can stitch my donor graft. So that is there, and then this takes me to the last video over here, which is what if you don't get a bubble, right? You have done everything, no matter what, everything has gone white, there is no bubble. So here what I do, and this is my strategy, there are many different ways, as I showed you, layer by layer you can peel it off. But what I do here, I hydrate the residual stroma with BSS. Three or four quadrants, put a lot of BSS, and then with the knife blade, you cut along your circumference, everything is white. So as you're cutting deeper and deeper along the edge, and I'll show you over here, we'll start the cutting after hydration, you will see that black appearing. When you see that black color appearing, you know you've gone deep enough, and you will just make that initial cut manually, and the bubbles guide you. If you're seeing bubbles, you know you're not deep enough yet, you know that there is still some protection for you. You will never get as deep as decimates, you will never get as deep as the pre-decimates layer, but you get deep enough. And then, once you've done that 360 degrees, you can manually take off the stroma, bulk of it, leave what is there behind, and put your donor on. You will have a thicker graft. There will be an interface, but it is still a pretty good outcome, because the less tissue you leave behind, the clearer it is. The more tissue you leave behind, the more interface haze you get. Thank you.
Next time you will teach us something else. Next, we are going to talk about the techniques of manual lamellar keratoplasty. Before going to the technique of manual one, so I just, surface is one of the factors for which lamellar keratoplasty was not popular. If we believe that, if we go for this classification or subgroup, if we can divide the anterior lamellar keratoplasty into this subgroup, that is sulc and delc. Sulc, in true sense, when we are saying sulc or superficial anterior lamellar keratoplasty, it is less than 160 micrometer. And more than that, we say in the true sense, we say delc. Why it is so, if I am saying that if it is sulc, then we have to say the manual method has to be obsolete. Why so? Because as we all know, the anterior layer of the cornea is tightly packed than the posterior one. Therefore, if you are separating in the anterior layer with a corneal dissector or crescent knife, it is likely to get the irregular surface. If we go to the other classification, like if we can divide lamellar keratoplasty into anterior and posterior, anterior we can again divide it into onlay and inlay. Inlay should include anterior lamellar keratoplasty, deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. When we say about inlay, that is also conventional and modified. Why I am giving emphasis on this? If we go for ALTK or femto or something else, it is not possible to do the surgery in the modified one. Yes, for subtotal one, that is the conventional one, we can use the anterior lamellar microkeratome or something, or femto, but not otherwise. Why so? The segmental, it will be difficult, even keyhole pattern, it will be difficult, annular, it will be difficult, and sclerocorneal also will be difficult. Here, manual dissection has an edge over the other procedure. Once we are speaking about manual method of dissection, it is layer by layer method, whether it is unedited or edited. Again, layer by layer can be with suture or with glue. Edit, as I said, as we discussed earlier, that it can be air edit, methyl cellulose, or hydrodelamination, and all three are comparable. Only and other planolenticle we have already spoke. Coming to the layer by layer method, this is the anterior one. Now we are doing the open method. Here, this manual method, the first one I have shown, that is conventional one, and this is the modified one, that if we have to do the corneoscleral one, how we are going to fix the microkeratom or ALTK machine for that. Even manually, desmatorexis is possible very well. When we require the very thick, means almost total corneal lenticle except the endothelium, then we can do this method and use in the anterior lamellar keratoplasty and deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. This is the post op feature. Then other one is annular. You can see that this is a case of annular dermoid. Do you think in this case we could have used ALTK or femto? Definitely not. So manual method is helpful in this situation. Another one is large diameter lamellar keratoplasty. Though it is not regularly being done, but still also if we have to do, we have to do the manual dissection. ALTK is not at all possible, then how we are going to fix, because it is, the blade is fixed, so we cannot do this type of surgery by using that. Especially in the Indian situation where we have the highly vascularized cornea and total corneal lesion, so we have to go for this. Sometimes this one also acts as the preparatory one. This is the donor preparation. In a king clamp, we have fixed the donor lenticle. Then with a corneal dissector, by closed method, we can do the separation. Donor separation by closed method, from the donor separation is much easier than the recipient, because donor cornea is slightly, it matters. This is the post, end of the surgery. Coming to the early dissection manually. Doing the lamellar separation. First layer is removed. The second layer is being removed now. Then donor tissue, and then the end of the surgery. This is the steps of surgery as I showed. This is something, the combined surgery. The for peripheral corneal ectasia with total cataract. Here in this case, phaco could not have been done, because if we would have done phaco, clear corneal incision was not possible in this case, which is extremely thin cornea. So we have decided to do manual small incision cataract surgery from the corneal scleral preparation, and before that we have done the anterior lamellar keratoplasty, that is segmental one. Then this is followed by the manual small incision cataract surgery. It is the conventional one. Then the last one is anterior lamellar keratoplasty with glue, that is sutureless lamellar keratoplasty. Here also we have used the manual method. One can use manual method very well after removing the recipient anterior stroma. A thorough wash is given to the recipient bed. No fiber, no blood tinge should be there. After cleaning and drying, getting it dried, the glue has to be applied, fibrin glue has to be applied all over the surface. Then the partial thickness donor tissue will be taken and put over the recipient bed. And the gentle pressure will be there for about 2 to 3 minutes. And that is the end of the surgery. So as I said, is it the manual method is obsolete? Definitely not. Even recent literature said by this method we can do the lamellar keratoplasty and also posterior lamellar keratoplasty with manually dissected donor tissue conveniently can be done. So to conclude, manual dissection technique has an edge over, as I said, than other method, as it is feasible for all types of corneal lesion irrespective of the site and size of the lesion. However, experience and patience of the person is mandatory. Thank you so much.
Sir, at Dr. Rajendra Prasad Center, President of IVANC Association of India and whatnot.
Thank you, ma'am, for the kind introduction and good afternoon, everyone. As ma'am mentioned, when you have more anterior layer involvement, which is not amenable to a PTK, so it's deeper than what is treatable by a phototherapeutic keratoplasty, a keratectomy, then an ALTK microkeratome assisted lamellar keratoplasty is better because you get a smoother bed. And all said and done, when you go to the deeper layers of the cornea and go for a DALC, if the lesion is very superficial, one would like to avoid that situation because one may sometimes have an accidental perforation. Though with better understanding and better surgical skills for DALC, there is an argument that whether one really should be doing any ALTK and whether straight away go for DALC. So that is a controversy which every surgeon decides on a case-to-case basis and also individual preference. So here's a case of a 20-year-old male who had painless diminution of vision in both eyes, and he had this bilateral symmetrical white opacities involving the anterior stroma, and was clinically diagnosed as a corneal dystrophy involving the Bowman's membrane. And this was confirmed with an ASOCT, and this was bilateral. Patient's vision was hampered, and the plan was to go for surgery. It was when, as I mentioned before, you will consider the depth of the opacity. If it's less than 100 microns, one would consider a PTK. 100 to 200 microns, superficial anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Mid stroma, you have the option of ALTK versus HALC. And in the posterior stroma level, if one is doing the dissection, it will be considered a DALC. So the management options, as I mentioned, involving more than 100 micron depth, the choice was for an anterior lamellar keratoplasty versus a DALC versus a PK. And when you're considering an ALTK, you have an option of a manual. You can have the option of a manual LK, ALTK if you have access to the microkeratome. And sometimes a hemi-automated lamellar keratoplasty is done where you cut the donor lenticule with the microkeratome and the host dissection is done manually. So the decision for surgery, there is a manual recipient bed lamellar dissection, automated donor preparation using the microkeratome, combines the benefits of a smooth microkeratome lamellar dissection of the donor and a customized lenticule thickness or depth, because you can continue the dissection up to the level that you have removed all the opacities with a manual dissection for the recipient. As far as the donor preparation, you have an artificial anterior chamber. You must have an adequate rim, so the IBANC has to be informed that you require at least 2 millimeter rim all around the limbus. This is important because a lot of IBANCs are doing in situ excision of the corneal button, and often the technicians have a tendency to cut a very small rim. And an intraoperative OCT, if available, is very useful. So this is how the surgery is done. As Srila Pitanga mentioned, you have the artificial anterior chamber, you fit the cornea into it with the fluid on, and then you check for the tension to make sure there's adequate pressure, and then the microkeratome blade is moved across it, and you have your lenticule ready for transplantation. And this is an example of a hemi-automated lamellar keratoplasty where the host dissection has been done assisted by the Hesburgh Baron Trafine. So you go to the requisite was a depth, and then you can complete it with a guarded diamond knife. And then when once one has got the initial incision, one can complete the dissection with a crescent blade. The other alternative is to cut the recipient bed with the microkeratome itself, similar to the microkeratome that one used to use for cutting a LASIK flap, where the stem is kept nasally, this little knob is on the temporal side, the microkeratome blade head fits over here and it rotates circularly to cut the tissue corresponding. And if you have IOCT guidance, it definitely helps you during such surgery. This is an example of the post-operative outcome. This was deeper tissue, so it had to be sutured, and as ma'am mentioned, if it is superficial, you can even fix it with glue. This is an example of a 1 week post-operative picture of that patient, and the corresponding deeper tissue was used for a DSEC, and this is the ASOCT of the patient who underwent the DSEC. So as far as the clinical examination is concerned, one will assess the patient preoperatively. Sometimes you may have very fine opacities where they're producing a lot of aberrations, lot of glare, and the patient is visually disabled. So though the vision may sometimes be 6/18 or 6/12, it can be quite visually debilitating, and one has to take the decision to do the surgery. This is an example of a patient who had anterior stromal dystrophy, and there were a few lesions posteriorly, but it was not believed that they were not believed to be responsible for that much of problem for the patient. So it was mainly this anterior opacity which we had to get rid of. Again, it was deeper than the 100 microns, so it was not amenable to a PTK. So this patient, this is the example of the ASOCT. As you can see that the lesions are deeper, so a PTK would not work. So here we have done a superficial sutureless anterior lamellar keratoplasty. This is an example of the donor preparation. Again, you put the cornea with the adequate rim. As you can see, there's a very large rim here, almost 4 millimeters all around. You place it on the artificial anterior chamber, fix it in place, put the anterior ring, make sure that it is tight and there's no leakage. Sometimes if the rim is a little small, you can decenter it slightly, but before you start, you must make sure that you have a tight seal, and then the tissue is cut. You will choose your microkeratome blade depending upon the depth that you want to cut. Here the tissue has been cut and the lenticule is being lifted. And as far as the recipient bed is concerned, this was a superficial involvement. So you mark the size that you are going to trephine, mark the center. This patient has been operated under block, which is why the pupil is dilated. And in this case, we didn't have access to the Hesburgh-Baron trephine, so a gentle mark is being made with a disposable trephine, and then a graded diamond knife to give you the required depth. You deepen it all around and then complete the dissection using a crescent blade. Try to remain in the same plane and not produce any further deeper cuts. Generally, one would keep the same size for the donor and the recipient cut in such cases, or only 0.25 larger, and then you will punch the donor according to the size. So this is the donor lenticule which had been cut with the LTK machine. Now it's being punched to the required size. You can make a little pocket peripherally to help tuck the excess tissue in. Just check for the fitting, to because sometimes the shape may be a little bit different. So check what is the most comfortable, and then one could apply fibrin glue to the bed. Wait for it to set. You may apply gentle pressure to massage it. Make sure that you do not inject too much glue, and then put a bandage contact lens. So this is the example of the patient post-operatively. You can sometimes see the fibrin glue at the bed. And what we started doing now is, if it is very smooth and very superficial, we just put the glue at the periphery and not at the base. And this is how the patient looked post-operatively. So basically the problems are, of course, that you can have interphase haze, you can have astigmatism despite using the glue, and you can also have a problem of focal or partial, that was from another talk, I was copying the slide. So the main problem is the scarring and the astigmatism. Thank you.
Then everything it covers, LTK, everything it covers if you want. Otherwise, I'm going to invite Dr. Vanathi. She is going to tell us all about DALC.
Thank you, ma'am. I believe you had a lot of talks and videos on DALC. All you'll have to understand what you mean by DALC. Today we have two types of DALC which we perform. It could be the Desmets-Barring DALC, which is the D-DALC, or you have the maximal depth of the pre-Desmets DALC, which is known as the PD-DALC. So most of you as beginners, you might land up doing a PD-DALC. And today, as against what was considered earlier, is a PD-DALC is as good as a D-DALC, though the interface scarring could present, but it's now considered to be quite minimal depending upon how well you have done your dissection and how much of less trauma you induced to the residual bed. So that's about what you would probably aim to do. And as a beginner, it's always better to err on the side where you would probably be able to use non-optical gray tissues for your corneal pathologies and help to expand the utilization of their tissues. So this is what the difference is about an LK without maximal depth and an LK with a maximal depth. So looking at when do you want to recommend deep anterior lacrimal keratoplasty, and why do you want to recommend is that deep anterior keratoplasty retains the host recipient endothelium, and which is integral to the corneal the corneal's tectonic strength, and again it almost functions as an extraocular procedure. So you're doing away with all the grave complications of an intraocular procedure, but always remember it is technically more demanding. There is a learning curve associated to it, and you probably will have to perform your dull cases maybe under the comfort of general anesthesia initially, and you need a cooperative patient and will need a backup of an optical grade tissue for most of your cases. Okay, and how you have to understand is that to master your deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty technique, this is what you have to understand, that the best way is you take a supervised learning course and then all resort to self-learning, learn to understand and choose your cases correctly, and what are the preoperative investigations which are going to enhance your decision stepwise in all your cases, particular intraoperative considerations which can do away with the chance of a perforation, or how well you can manage a perforation if it occurs, and the postoperative management in most cases. So I'll run you through preoperative conditions. Today we do DALCs as an optical procedure, as a therapeutic procedure, or as a tectonic procedure. So as is always known, most of us do it for primary stromal diseases as keratoconus, for stromal dystrophies, and for degenerations of the cornea. And the others could be advanced conditions, especially we are now extending it onto extensively scarred, chemically injured corneal surfaces, where we are following up stem cell transplants with our deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty manual procedures, where you probably cannot bubble in these cases as well. And of course, post-lasic keratectasias and post-graft ectasias, again, conditions where you could consider doing a deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Today, in the management of keratitis, when keratitis is limited to the anterior two-thirds of the cornea, you could think about doing a therapeutic DALC, which helps you to, again, optimally utilize your non-optical gray tissue. And if you could give a good visual acuity of 6/24, 6/18 for these patients, vis-a-vis aiming a 6/6, it still does work well and has a dual purpose of controlling the infection and also refractively rehabilitating a patient. Of course, tectonic focal DALCs are DALCs which are probably localized to a particular area, very much akin to a lamellar patch graft, is one which you could probably be looking at What you need to know is what are the techniques you need to understand, go by and read, look at a lot of videos of that. But most of us, in clear cases, we would do a big bubble dart. But as we are doing and as we are increasing our comfort levels, we do now achieve our manual dart techniques are becoming more and more predictable. The certain percentage of unpredictability which occurs in big bubble dart is done away with, and you're still be able to proceed doing a good surgery, which is as good as that in a big bubble dart. Just to run you through what is a big bubble test, and again the type 1, type 2, type 3 bubbles I think must have been covered earlier, so I would not repeat those again. I'll just run you through a short video of a big bubble dart. Here is your depth of trephination is going to be important, so your preoperative workup, looking at your corneal thickness of what will be the preset depth to which you're going to trephine the cornea. A perfect perpendicular trephination is going to help you in removing the stromal layer, so that's going to be a key in your thing. And again, learning to place your needle and pass the bubble on well enough is going to be the trick. Most of it is by the feel. Today we do have intraoperative OCTs which help us to judge where exactly we are placing the needles or move away from thinned out areas. But this is what you'll have to learn and learn to master, and this is an imperative step. Again, I will remind you to perform your stab incisions or do a paracentesis before you do your manual. You do your big bubbling, because you don't want if you are a beginner, you don't want a taut anterior chamber for a very long period of time. You can land up with this high pressure crossing a urethra, and that could actually compromise the results of a well done surgery. So a paracentesis, and if you prefer the technique of doing an anterior lamellar delamination before bubbling, do it before you do your lamination before you do. As experienced surgeons, some of us do your anterior delaminations after we bubble, but don't do it if you are a beginner. And once you have achieved a big bubble stack, as you can see in this case, you see the bubble is there right in the center, and you see the bubble put into AC is all pushed into the center, which is the big bubble test or the small bubble test, which says that your bubble is lying in the exact interface where it has to be. If you're a little scared in slashing right in the center, performing the brave slash, what I do in some of my cases is do my brave slash at the side and fill it with viscoelastic, and then complete your layer by your divide and conquer of removing the residual stroma or de-roofing the compartment which contains the air, and then you could proceed with your surgery. So these are simple tips which can help you to achieve good success or alleviate or decrease the chances of perforation in most of your cases. I'll leave, I think, Rishi to cover all the advanced things. Just a tip on how you would do a therapeutic dart is, remember, you won't be able to trephine these cases. They are for the risk of perforation. Be careful when you're inserting your speculum. Several times you could rupture your desmoseal when you're just inserting a speculum. The comfort of a general anesthesia is almost mandatory in most of these cases. And you could do a visco separation, or you could do a manual separations. Most of the time we do use conventional instrumentations. I think Srilaka already covered on this, so I won't go into these as well. But be careful, even at this stage, you could land up with a perforation, and a well done surgery could go away. Just a word to show you how intraoperative OCT today helps us in with better and advanced imaging, has really enhanced the comfort level. So if you, most of us now have shifted to doing just manual darts, you know how deep you're going in, because you have the comfort and the luxury of looking at where your blade is actually touching upon, and you could go to the maximal depth, and this by doing your manual procedures itself, and also in cases where a big bubble dart is not possible. And again, this comfort level has helped us to prevent converting a perforated dart continue with a manual dart procedure and avoid an double anterior chamber in your postoperative phase. So that's the comfort level which these newer machines are giving us. With this, I will stop and I'll hand over the podium to Rishi and welcome you all to the annual DOS conference, DOSCON 2017, in April 7th to 8th in New Delhi. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Vanathi. When we are doing the therapeutic DALC, in wet tumor, if it is a case of fungal keratitis, you have to be very careful. Then it will act as a preparatory only. For bacteria, it is okay.
Thank Dr. Panda and Dr. Vanathi for inviting me to be part of this course, and it's always nice to be with them here. So most of the things have actually been covered, so sorry for the repetition for the garden variety keratoconus and scars. But sometimes we encounter these kind of very, very thinned out corneas, or corneas which are very thin in the periphery, like in a pellucid or a keratoglobus, or you may have scars which are going deep in your stroma and touching the desmes, patients who have had high drops. These are the cases that are really challenging to do a dial in. And of course, therapeutic dials sometimes can be challenging as well. So when you say advanced ectasia, the cornea is either too thin, or it's too ectatic, or the cone is too large. Preoperatively, when we are assessing these cases, it's important to see the size and location of the pathology. Especially, it's important to see if the desmes membrane is free from the pathology, because if you're going to do a big bubble technique where you're trying to separate the Duwa's layer or the desmes from the stroma, it should separate easily. If you have an old high drops, then there's a high chance of perforation if you're trying to do a desmetic dalk. It's also important to identify if the pathology which you want to remove, especially in ectasia, is closer to, is involving the peripheral cornea, because if it is, we know that the big bubble doesn't ever extend to the peripheral cornea. It only goes to about 8.5. So the peripheral dissection will have to be done manually. So you might want to just do a manual dalk in these cases. You also want to see how advanced the thinning is. If it's very, very thinned out, sometimes it also makes the cornea very fragile and ruptures very easily during maneuvers. Intraoperative OCT, preoperative OCT is a very, very useful tool to identify what exactly is going on in the stroma, where is the epithelium thickened, how is the stroma underlying it, how deep is your pathology, the scar, how deep does it go. Are there any irregularities in the desmes membrane which probably are indicative of an old high drops? So these are very, very invaluable tools in planning for a dalk, and any dalk surgeon should ideally have access to an OCT. Big bubble technique we know is the gold standard, and no other technique can give you the beautiful clean bed that a big bubble gives you. All other manual techniques will have a little more rough texture to the bed. Having said that, manual techniques do give pretty good results if you are deep enough. So the key, like Dr. Vanathi said, is to do that brave slash so that the air comes out in a controlled manner. A good idea is to put a drop of dispersive viscoelastic sealing the perforation so that the air comes out very slowly. And I think we saw a video of that by Dr. Dua. What I do in many of these advanced ectasias is I use manual dalk, because the working space to introduce a needle or a cannula sometimes is less in advanced ectasias. Also, we don't have to really go into the central cornea in manual dalk if you use this technique that I'm showing to you. It's what I call it, the groove and peel technique. So basically, we make a peripheral gutter in the cornea and we go all around, and then after completing one circle, we start going in a deeper plane and basically use a normal curved universal corneal scissor to do this dissection. You go in with your blade closed and open it inside. And because the curve is pointing upward, there's very little chance of really perforating the deeper layer. And you keep doing that till you start seeing that glassy layer, which is basically the pre-desmetic Duwa's layer. And once you've reached that layer, expose about 2 or 3 clockas of that layer, and then you can, once that potential space is found, you can just use stretch forces to open up the rest of that space. So basically you use a forceps and grasp that central line of stroma and peel the entire stroma off that. You can give countertraction at the limbus or at the graft trepanation edge. And basically you use stretch forces distributed over a large area, which makes this dissection safer. Second thing is, you're not putting any instrument in the central cornea. All your instrumentation happens in the peripheral cornea, so the chance of perforation is much, much lesser, unless you have a deep scar or something like that which causes addition of that stroma to the deeper layer. Just to demonstrate that in various
conditions, you can do it quite nicely. Even in the areas where you are not dissected in the periphery, it just opens up and the whole space, you see how clean that is. Just peels off very nicely. It's a good idea to do it in a controlled manner, re-grasping again and again, so that the whole stroma can be taken off quite nicely. And you have these little fibers which don't really matter. And the optical and the visual result will be as good as, almost as good as a big bubble talc. So just to show you that it can be done again and again, I've done it in over hundreds of cases and it's quite repeatable. Of course, you do have perforation every now and then if you don't select your cases properly. But in most of the cases, you can do this quite well. And often you are very, very near desmes. It may not be exactly at the duas layer. You might have a little bit of stroma here and there, but it's pretty clear. You can just to give you an example. This is a case in which we did this groove and peel manual talc, and you can see, even though it is quite an advanced ectasia with a scar, we managed on the very first day, you can see how clean the interface is, and you can see the air bubble in there. Keratoglobus, when you do dalk, I again use the same technique, I create the peripheral gutter and peel. I notice that it just peels off like a LASIK flap. There's really no attachment between the stroma and the pre-desmous layer in patients with keratoglobus. There's something going on there. So I don't know what exactly it is, but you see how easily the scissor glides in also. And when you peel in the, in the areas where you haven't really done much, it just comes off. So you see, it just comes off, and there's really nothing attaching the stroma to the bed. If you have a central pathology, a femtosecond laser is a very useful tool to do a good and reliable deep lamellar keratoplasty. One of the reasons is because you know how deep your inner cut is, the ring lamellar cut and the posterior side cut, and so you can introduce your instruments at a preset depth because of that. And of course the other advantages of better apposition and lower astigmatism are always there. So just to show that visco bubble is another alternative. If you don't get a big bubble, you can just put in viscoelastic there, and that works equally well provided it goes in the right plane. Although cohesive viscoelastic can be is recommended, even dispersive viscoelastic can be used, and when you wash it, it really comes off quite nicely. It's not really a problem. Therapeutic dalks is something I have done for many of these patients, especially acanthamoeba. It works quite well. You can do a big bubble or manual. I've noticed that the stroma is quite spongy in these cases, and if you find the right plane, it comes off very easily actually. And you don't really have to dissect too much to find the right plane. And many of these patients do quite well, and you get optical results from a therapeutic procedure. If you have surface problems like these, you can combine it with a stem cell or a limbal clet in this particular case, but you could do a slit also and get very good results. Especially in corneas that are thinned out or scarred, you have to combine it with a lamellar keratoplasty. So I think I'll just, I won't show you too many things. I'll just show you a couple of things. This is just to show that you can do a phaco quite well, even if you've gone down to the duas layer, it holds quite well. And I think Dr. Harminder Dua has also demonstrated that quite well. So you can dissect all the way down to the duas layer and do a phaco as usual and then put in the stromal button. This is just to show that even if you do have a perforation, in this particular case, I'm doing the bracelage, but I was being over aggressive, and I, after puncturing the stroma, I also punctured the desmes. But you can put little patch of stroma there with fibrin glue and then put your graft in, and later you could just gently kind of peel that patch off once you've put your graft and put air in the anterior chamber. So that way you can get a clean interface. Like I said, even in the groove and peel techniques, if you have had an old hydrops, you can have perforation like this, but if you manage it well with air, you have that little triangle there, but you get a clear graft, and this patient, eventually I did a toric IOL for him and did quite well. type 2 bubbles have been shown to us by Dr. Dua, and basically that's what it looks like, the type 2 bubble. You can puncture it if you get it, and you can sometimes expose the desmase like this, but you have to be very careful. It ruptures on touch, like you will see right now. This is a therapeutic DALC that I'm doing. Everything's going very well, but probably I should have decompressed the anterior chamber with through a paracentesis at this point. See that? The whole thing ruptures. So DALC is, of course, the gold standard for surgical treatment of isolated stromal disease. Although big bubble is preferable, manual may be a good alternative in advanced scenarios. And most challenging situations in DALC can be overcome to complete a successful DALC if you know what to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rishi. One thing, Dr. Rishi has shown very good videos, recipient bit. So all the time you use the visco over that, otherwise that will be edematous and your visibility will be poor.
Okay.
So this thing one
I think has that's a great tip. Thank you, ma'am.
One has to remember that.
So now we'll come down to desec to the posterior surface of the cornea. We'll go from the anterior surgeries. And training grade corneas, better to practice yourself a lot before going for actual using optical optical grade of tissues. So the anterior artificial anterior chamber should be which is very handy, like we can tilt as you dissect, because always your plane of dissection should be in plane, like it should be horizontal. So you have to tilt the anterior chamber, which I'll be showing in the video later. Like in the first half of the dissection, it should be against you, and the next half of the dissection, it should be towards you, so that the plane of dissection will be always horizontal. And so that if it is light and it can be held in the hand, it will be comfortable for you. And the same way, the dissection and the initial cut can be done with the guarded blade and also various dissectors of various length according to the area where we are dissecting. And coming to the donor tissue, like it should be ideal, but to be more than 2500 cells count. But more importantly, it should be of the cell morphology, which is very uniform, and it should be fresh tissue with relatively young donors. So the donor tissue preparation we will see now. And in this, getting a very watertight anterior chamber is very important in the artificial chamber. And so for that, we should get, of course, our corneoscleral rim should be large, but it should not be too large, otherwise it can get caught in between the different components of the artificial anterior chamber, and that can lead on to leak. So it should be trimmed to the ideal shape, size, and also it should be devoid of any tenons and other soft tissue over the sclera. It should be completely dissected before we fix it in the artificial anterior chamber. And as we can see here, there is the artificial the chamber is filled with an air bubble, as well as we can use a tip of a drop of OVD also, and air bubble and the irrigating solution, because this air bubble interface will help in when we start dissecting, it will help in assessing the depth to which we have gone. And the size should be checked for leak, and the pressure should be optimal. It should not be too tight, it should not be too soft also. So, and another clue is the ease with which the instrument moves. So that shows that it is definitely in the posterior layers, not too in the anterior layer too much. So let us see the whole video now. So the artificial chamber, first you check whether there is no block and also there is no leak. Then put a just small drop of OVD. You need not fill it with the OVD. Then put the tissue and check whether it is of the right size, the scleral rim, and whatever extra tissue you remove. Then fix it and lock it. So after you lock it, check all around whether there is any leak. Then you can remove some of the epithelium if it is edematous. Then check the pressure. Here it is too much. So reduce the pressure a little bit so that it should dimple a little bit. The pressure should be only that much, and you can just mark the limbus for later. This thing, now you can remove the syringe and hold the thing in your hand only, so that you can tilt it. So the initial, during the initial off of the procedure, it will be tilted towards you. So here you can make a bold cut and also check how deep you have gone. So as I told you, like it can be tilted towards you. Then I use a micro crescent to start initiate the dissection and to assess how deep I have gone. So the in the with the interface, air interface, we can see actually the reflection as we do in the dark Mellis method, so that we can see and see, you can see the, when you are pressing it, you can see the small halo of dark halo with which you can assess the depth of the thing. You can increase the form zoom and you can see, and then you can proceed with the dissector. So the dissector usually, like it will be relatively blunt than the keratome, and even the keratome can be used once you gain experience. Then the dissection should be should go from limbus to limbus. As you can see here now, like we can use this dissector till you cross the midline, the center of the thing where we marked, and after that we take a longer dissector which is more blunt, and at this stage we tilt the thing towards you, so that's why it is going out of the field, and then you invert it and then remove it so that it won't get collapsed and the endothelium will not be damaged, and rest of it as your like the desired size we can define, we can punch it, and then you can see the assess the your graft thickness also later. So as you can see here, you can assess and so that you can plan your further procedure accordingly. So sometimes you can end up with perforation. It's very important because if the anterior chamber is locked and if the IOP is too high, that in the artificial chamber pressure is too high, then you can end up with having perforation even with a blunt instrument like that, even towards the end of the dissection. So that's why it should be very important to get the optimal pressure. And even if you get a perforation like this, here it is almost in the periphery. So you can still use this tissue easily. You can decenter it because we are not bothered about the limbus here. You can decenter it a little bit and you can make a smaller graft. Otherwise, you go to the other side and restart the dissection slightly at the higher level and finish it, and then you can still use the tissue. You need not waste the tissue. So in conclusion, it is a very elegant procedure, but it needs, especially manual dissection, needs a learning curve and practice a lot. And if you, and of course you should learn the procedure even if you are going to use a automated dissection, because even in the automated dissection sometimes it can fail. So you may need to convert it into manual dissection. So it's always in hand, like it will be very handy to learn this procedure properly. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Revati. Any question to...
Good question. What happens with these peripheral thinnings is that, like for example, if you have pellucid marginal degeneration, you can do a limbus to limbus dissection and do a peripheral tuck-in procedure as a flange. Sometimes what you could do is also a peripheral crescent and then a central keratoplasty later on. But that peripheral tuck-in keratoplasty works well.
I have shown this video of peripheral graft. No? I have shown that along with the segment. Same thing you have to do for either pellucid degeneration or Terence degeneration. You have to do that. Thank you. Thank you very much. My special thanks to the audience. Few people only are there. Thanks to all the speakers for the wonderful talk. And my very special thanks to Dr. Savita Parida, who has come from UK after listening about our lamellar keratoplasty to listen to the lamellar keratoplasty. And she is so lucky that Dr. Dua also spoke something. Thank you, Dr. Savita.